Everybody, and welcome to the WWE SmackDown review for March 12th, 2015. Now, before I get into the review, I do want to mention that I wasn't able to upload my Q&A video on Wednesday, not because I didn't have time to film it, but because I had some upload issues, which I obviously wasn't expecting to occur, but I used YouTube Capture to put up my videos, and for whatever reason, some of the Q&As always have a harder time because they're much lengthier than my normal reviews and whatnot. So, of course, I had a difficulty uploading it, and it's quite frustrating because, you know, I spent a lot of time doing the Q&A video only for it not to upload. So I figured I'm just going to throw it out and re-record it, and I'm going to upload that version on Saturday the 14th. So I hope you guys will stay tuned and will go ahead and check out that Q&A when it goes up on Saturday. But unfortunately, that's going to be the way that things are. For the time being, tomorrow night we'll be having the Impact review, so 3 days, three videos. Impact or SmackDown tonight, Impact tomorrow, and then the Q&A on Saturday, so please bear with me here. It'll be up, though, and then after that, I'm hoping to do a WrestleMania-themed Q&A right before the show, like a couple days before WrestleMania 31. Any questions related strictly to WrestleMania, I don't want to say start asking them now, but I might as well say start asking them now. So yeah, go ahead. Q&A, WrestleMania edition. You have till like 2 weeks from now to ask those questions, or close to it. Not quite, but just under 2 weeks. But I want to give people some time to think up some questions. So even if you don't have them for tonight, you don't have to worry about it. Saturday when I do the Q&A would be a great time to start asking. So this is what I'll say. Start thinking about your questions for the WrestleMania Q&A. Don't ask them until the Q&A, this Q&A goes up on Saturday. So enough rambling. Let's get into SmackDown, as hard as it was to get into it. Let's get into it. Daniel Bryan has a promo where, you know, he talks about how he has to accept the fact that, you know, he isn't going to relive last year. And, you know, he wants to fight for the Intercontinental Championship and prove why he can make the Intercontinental title picture more important, more enjoyable, more entertaining than even the world title picture, like some of the legends over the years, such as Bret Hart, Randy Savage, Mr. Perfect, etc. Bad News Barrett ends up coming out and saying that even though, you know, he can't seem to find his championship, he is going to walk out with the title. Dolph Ziggler ends up coming out saying that Barrett is delusional for even thinking so because he can't hang on to the title. Luke Harper doesn't say a whole lot besides that he wants his WrestleMania moment. Dean Ambrose wants to fight. Stardust ends up coming out searching for the title. R-Truth gets out on the stage with the actual belt, and the six-man tag was basically set up from there for the main event, and the babyfaces got over in the opening brawl. Again, weird. It's always weird to me when, you know, you got seven people here fighting for the Intercontinental Championship, and yet it's like, yep, let's team up on SmackDown tonight to do what, really? I mean, is it getting that much momentum going? Now, the way SmackDown ended with a little bit of some energy thrown in there and some potential conflict between the babyfaces was a good thing to end SmackDown, because otherwise it's like, yeah, we're teaming up. Why throw everyone together on teams, you know? I mean, I just think that this segment in of itself probably would have been enough, but I guess they really don't have enough other things to use to build up WrestleMania this year, as weird as that might sound, that they actually have done a lot of focus on the Intercontinental Championship. And is it nice to have a lot of focus on the Intercontinental Championship? I don't think anybody is saying no to that, but it's the fact that it's a multi-man ladder match and the belt feels so unimportant because the guy who holds it doesn't feel important. And you're putting a bunch of guys together who have lost a bunch of matches and who aren't really all that relevant other than Daniel Bryan. I think Daniel Bryan deserves a much bigger and better spot than this Intercontinental Championship ladder match. I just don't think this does enough for the belts. Now, is the attention nice on the title, like I've said in the past? Yes. But I can't find myself getting into this ladder match because of the fact that it's going to have some nice spots, but the belt is nowhere near going to mean anything after this. We already know where this is going, and that's why I just cannot get into it for me. And this promo was, you know, this segment would have just been fine if that was all we really got. I don't think we needed a six-man tag, even though the six-man tag, to me, was pretty enjoyable. I'll talk more about it as I get through the show. But this was an okay way to open SmackDown. It wasn't amazing by any means. If anything, just continues to, you know, fuel my fire and fuel the point that I've been making, that this is a big clusterfuck of a match. And it's like, yes, is it getting some good talents on WrestleMania? Sure. But is it doing it in an effective enough way that makes this championship not feel like a comedy act rather than a serious thing to fight for? And even though I saw some tension between the babyfaces at the end of the night, they're still making it more of a comedic thing than they are an actual serious thing. So that annoys me on top of it. But anyway, let's move on. The first match of the night was an 8-man tag. Los Matadores and Cesaro and Kid team up. Apparently Los Matadores are heels now. Go figure. And they end up defeating the New Day and the Usos. This was just all over the place. And one time, Byron Saxton himself said this is hard to follow. And you just echoed the voice of everyone watching. It was impossibly hard to follow because it was hard to tell who was on what team because these teams don't make any motherfucking sense. And again, we're getting the same several team tag team championship match from WrestleMania. It's like, we've seen that, you know, it's been the WrestleMania thing lately. I don't want that again. God, I just don't care. Like, this 8-man tag wasn't anything special to me. It was a clusterfuck, and I couldn't follow it because it was just so all over the place all at once. Really didn't do much for me at all. So, we move on. Miz and Ryback. Ryback obviously goes over quite simply. Not really much of a surprise there. Miz and Mizdow, they built that dynamic up a little bit by having, you know, Mizdow actually try to talk some sense into the Miz after, you know, he was interviewed after Renee Young had said that Ryback was one of the odds-on favorites to win the whole damn Battle Royal. But the Miz says, you know, gives his credentials as a reason. I think Miz played off the heel role really, really well here. I think he does that quite a bit, to be completely honest with you. But here was a nice example of how good Miz does as a heel. I always thought that Miz has been a pretty good heel. And I really want Miz and Mizdow in a singles match. But again, am I getting what I want? No. And I didn't even mention it, but I will take the time to now. I'm freaking beyond disappointed over the fact that Goldust and Stardust are not going to have a singles match at WrestleMania. What blows my mind about that is that they started the feud. They built the feud. They even involved Dusty Rhodes. They had a match at Fastlane. Goldust went over in a stupid, like, in that stupid kind of not really a finish way, and I didn't really enjoy the match a ton, but I didn't mind the finish if that was leading to WrestleMania, which everyone assumed it was. And all of a sudden, even the week after WrestleMania, they're still building up Goldust and Stardust as a match because Goldust cost Stardust a match, and then Stardust beat the shit out of Goldust on SmackDown in the same after Fastlane. So it was clear that that was the intention, and all of a sudden they called an audible and decided to cancel what could have been one of the best matches from WrestleMania 31 and one of the matches that people have been looking forward to for four freaking years. It's ridiculous to me that they do that. That is so dumb. Stardust being in that Intercontinental title ladder match is freaking stupid. And the fact that Miz and Mizdow aren't getting their own one-on-one match is stupid too. I hope they're the last two guys in the Andre the Giant Memorial Battle Royal. I hope that the Miz or Mizdow ends up throwing Miz out and that's what wins him the match. But I kind of want Ryback to win the Battle Royal. That's been the guy that I've been pushing as the one that I think should win it. And then Miz and Mizdow should have a match and Mizdow should go over. Why can't they get a singles match? I don't get why that can't happen. So am I upset with the feuds? With the feud of Miz and Mizdow? Not really. I think it's been fine. But what I'm upset with is the fact that they are good enough to deserve their own singles match. I think they really are. And more importantly than that, I am upset with that we're not going to get Stardust and Goldust at all. After that was one of the matches at WrestleMania that people have been begging for 4 or 5 straight years. Their match at Fastlane may have been somewhat underwhelming, but I think they were just trying to hold back a lot of spots for Mania. I don't know why they decided to cancel this match or you know, go in a different direction, but I think it's a bad idea. That's just my opinion. Well, anyway, let's move on to the Reigns and Mark Henry segment where, you know, Reigns goes on about how Paul Heyman doesn't really know his family at all. You disrespected us on Raw. You know what I don't understand? Why the hell didn't Roman Reigns come out and face Paul Heyman straight up when he talked shit about his family? He had an opportunity right then and there to get in the ring with Brock Lesnar, to have a face-to-face confrontation with him and say straight to Heyman that you don't say that shit about my family. Why would you wait until SmackDown to have him come out and say those things? And then Mark Henry comes out of pretty much nowhere. But, you know, I kind of like the way that Mark Henry said that you can't. You, like, just how Roman Reigns was trying to make the point of, well, everyone says I can't, but I can and I will. And then Mark Henry says, no, you can't. Yeah, I love that. You know, no, you can't. You know, you haven't done anything yet. You got to earn the respect. Blah, blah, blah. You know, it was kind of a regular old spiel from a vet. But it made sense. And then for Roman Reigns to start to walk away and say, whatever, man, just made me, like, you know, toss my hands up. Like, why? Why would Roman Reigns say, whatever, man, to Mark Henry? Why wouldn't he say, oh, really? And get up in his face. And say that, no, I won the Royal Rumble, I got this spot, I earned this spot, you know, blah, blah, blah. Why wouldn't he say something along those lines instead of just being like, oh, whatever, man, you know what, you're right, man, I'm just going to leave the ring. Like, did Henry end up saying something else, and then did Reigns end up spearing him through a barricade and Superman punching him? Yes, he ended up doing what you wanted to, but unless Henry chimed in and said more, Roman Reigns was just going to walk away. Like, he was just going to walk away. That is just so dumb to me. Why would it take Mark Henry to have to say, hey, don't walk away from me? You're proving Mark Henry right that you haven't earned respect in the storyline. If they want to make Roman Reigns look like a legit, you know, top-level guy, you know, why the hell would he walk away and cower away like that? Why wouldn't he come out and face Heyman on Raw? These are the things that make or break that story. And the only thing that has, I mean, like I said, you know, in PWF Empire this week, like I said on Raw Review this week, you know, Heyman is the chemist, you know, stirring up the pot and making this feud actually have some substance to it. He is creating the substance only by himself. But it's not fair that Paul Heyman needs to carry a feud that Brock Lesnar and Roman Reigns haven't really done much of anything with, other than that face-to-face that they had, you know, back several weeks ago. Back in the beginning of February, and that was on a canceled Raw. Other than that, we haven't gotten Brock Lesnar and Roman Reigns face-to-face, and some people will say, oh, it's good that they haven't, you know, touched or anything, and it's not about them touching. It's about the fact that they could have a face-to-face confrontation in the ring, or a promo segment, or, you know, Reigns hits the Superman punch, Lesnar looks stunned, escapes the ring before he's able to hit a spear. It's not much of any contact. It builds the match up a little bit, gets the fans excited, and Paul Heyman still gets in his promo. Reigns looks like he actually wants to kick Lesnar's ass instead of sitting backstage and waiting until the next, or a few days later on SmackDown, to come out and talk about it. It just doesn't add up. The Mark Henry thing wasn't, like, terrible, but I didn't really find why it needed to happen. And since it did, he was like a wily veteran kind of, you know, talking to Reigns. I get that. But to have Reigns, like, almost walk away and have Henry have to entice him to come out with the aggression doesn't make any sense. Why wouldn't Reigns just get up in his face in the first place? You know, if he wants to prove that he can, why would he start walking away? That makes it look, you're proving Henry's point right there. And in the storyline, if you want to make Reigns try to be, you know, showing that he doesn't want to prove that point, that he wants to show that he really is going to be ready, then why would he do that? That doesn't make any sense. It's like taking a step backwards as far as I'm concerned. So, just frustration with the build for me. Let's move on. Divas stuff next. The Bellas were on commentary. Again, this whole match about Total Divas. Paige and AJ defeat Cameron and Summer Rae. Nothing real all that special in the match. Obviously, the right two went over. And there was a, you know, a confrontation on the outside, separated by a referee. Made it feel like there was some actual tension there. That was a nice piece to the puzzle. But again, trying to predicate that this match is built on Total Divas. It's not built on Total Divas. This match, the psychology of the beginning of this match was built when the Bellas were beating the shit out of Paige after the Divas title match a couple weeks ago, and AJ Lee came running out to make the save and even the odds. That is what this match is built off of, not on Total Divas. It has nothing to do with that. In fact, AJ Lee isn't even on Total Divas. So there you go. Why does it always have to be all about Total Divas? To mention Total Divas is one thing, but to kind of almost make it seem like this entire story only strictly has to do with the season finale and how Paige is an intricate part of the show. Now, Paige is anything but a Total Diva. It's disappointing to me that she's actually even on the show. I'll be honest with you there. really is a disappointing thing, because Paige isn't that type of diva in terms of her character on screen. Now, is she, you know, fun and whatnot? Yeah, sure, Paige is fun. But, like, you know, it just doesn't make a whole lot of sense for her to be on that show. Just like it didn't make any sense for AJ to be on the show, so why would she be? It would be cool if it was Paige and AJ, like, the anti, not necessarily anti-divas, but the non-total divas versus, you know, these pin-up, you know, fake plastic boob girls. Well, only one of them, but still. You know, basically the talented core and then the ones who are all about looks and whatnot. It's a nice blend, actually. But, you know, again, let's just make it all about total divas and some bullshit that happened on there. It's sad to me that that's the way that these stories are built. It's not about the fact that AJ returned to help Paige out, and that's the entire reason why this feud is happening. Let's not talk about that. So Orton had an interview with Michael Cole where he talks about how he was cold and calculated and everything. And, you know, all that other good stuff about how he, you know, thought about it and wanted to wait for the right moment to attack Seth Rollins. I still feel like Randy Orton is that aggressive guy who made, like, special ways to attack you, yes, but waiting, like, 3 weeks was a little bit odd to me. I still think it was odd. I'm glad we got the beatdown we got on Raw. It made me feel a lot better about this storyline between Rollins and Orton. But as I said on PWF this week, it's something that's really important for Randy Orton going forward now, or for Randy Orton and Seth Rollins, the storyline, is for Seth Rollins to look strong going into WrestleMania, because this guy has looked like an idiot. The fact that he completely believed that Randy Orton was going to just flat out not turn on him on this past week's Raw just made him look stupid. And this is the same guy who outsmarted his S.H.I.E.L.D. brethren. This is the same guy who joined the Authority because he knew it would be a big opportunity for his future. This is the same guy who, you know, won the Money in the Bank and has a guaranteed championship match. And this is the same guy who took out Randy Orton. He's cold and calculated, kind of like Orton, almost in a way, because he's calculated and smart and picks his spots and waits for the right moments. That's the character we've been given in Seth Rollins. And in January, when he had a title match against Brock and Cena, he looked like he was ready, in-ring-wise and story-wise, to be in there. He felt like a legit part of that match. And now, right now, he doesn't feel like he could actually go out there and beat Randy Orton. And that's something that I have seen a huge decrease in Seth Rollins' character and the way he's been booked. And the way that he got buried in that brawl, to me, wasn't that bad, because it was a brawl we needed to see. Or not even a brawl, just Orton's beatdown. That's something I wanted to see on the first Raw. I mean, call me impatient, or just have Orton return a little later than Fastlane, and then, you know, have him beat him down, then, you know, have Rollins escape that night, and then the next week, Orton, you know, comes in. Maybe he even says he'll tag with Rollins tonight and whatever, but it's just weird when Orton came out and started to attack everyone and looked like he wanted to kick the shit out of Rollins, and then the next night, they're, like, trying to coax him back, and he just takes it, and Rollins just buys into it. Even though Rollins just ran for his life the night before, it just doesn't make continuous sense. So the continuity of that doesn't make much sense to me. Now, am I looking forward to Orton and Rollins? Yes, you better believe it. But Seth Rollins needs to look strong going into WrestleMania. And it starts next week. He needs to plot a way to get revenge on Orton, and it needs to work completely. He needs to curb stomp him in the ring next week and look really strong and beat the hell. Like, basically, not the exact opposite of what Orton did to him, but he needs to get over on this week's Raw. That is going to be extremely important for Seth Rollins, because right now, he doesn't look like he can actually go out there and beat Randy Orton. It won't be that credible of a victory as it should be. He should feel like he's on the same level as Randy Orton. It shouldn't feel like Rollins has to do all this shit just to win the match, where at Royal Rumble, he held his own and almost won the damn belt. So he proved right then and there that he doesn't always need the help, but he gets the help when he needs it, and it works for his character. But I think at that big match situation with, like, an Orton, he doesn't need that help at that time. Like, he doesn't need it all the time. He needs it when he needs it, but, you know, in those big match situations, he can go out there and still get it done. And that's what I liked about the way that Seth Rollins was booked. They always made you hate him just enough and then still made him look strong enough to be able to go out there and stand on his own two feet. So that's what I really liked about Seth Rollins' booking, and that's what I'm really disliking about the way it's been going the last several weeks. So the six-man tag main event, I actually enjoyed a good deal. Like, Bryan, Ziggler, and Ambrose defeat Luke Harper, Bad News Barrett, Stardust. I'm not surprised babyfaces went over. It was a little weird. Luke Harper probably should have gotten the pinfall on Dolph Ziggler. I think they made it kind of ridiculous that Harper put Ziggler through hell, and all of a sudden, boom, there it is. You know, the zigzag and the match is over. That was kind of an odd way to finish things, if you ask me. But, you know, other than that, I really thought this was a quite entertaining main event. You know, it was enjoyable, it was solid, but again, the build of the Intercontinental Championship match is weird, and then to have it end with both Ziggler and Ambrose calling Bryan a turd, again, it just makes it feel more comedic, like they were being sarcastic and comedic and ha-ha, you know, jabbed ya kind of deal, rather than like, no, I want WrestleMania spotlight for me, I want that Intercontinental Championship for me, I want to be that next legend, that next hero, who makes the IC title the most important title in wrestling. Like, those kind of things are what I want to hear more of. And, like, Ziggler did say, like, you know, don't forget I'm in the match and stuff. So it started off well, and then the turd thing at the end was just kind of like, oh, man. But, you know, honestly, it was an enjoyable main event. I just think it's weird when it's a multi-man match, and every man is for himself, and then three people team up on both sides. They always do this with the build for a lot of things like this. I wish it was a thing that we got a little less often. I don't mind it every now and then, but like when everyone's vying for a prize, it's kind of odd when they're teaming together. Like, why do the babyfaces have to all instantly get along? Like, why would Dean Ambrose get along with anybody? Dean Ambrose is the lunatic fringe, you know? I mean, maybe I'm overthinking the damn thing, but I really wouldn't have minded just seeing, like, everybody kind of get at it and brawl. Kind of like we saw in the past. Like, you know, there was always kind of a back and forth with everybody before, you know, last week. But again, I don't like the ladder match concept for the Intercontinental title. I don't think it needs to happen at WrestleMania. I'm not excited about it. It's just going to, you know, be a spotty match that doesn't do anything for the belt in the long run. Again, this is the same belt that is held by a guy who is made to look like a complete fool. More importantly than that, it feels like a comedic thing, especially when R-Truth, a guy who is just cracking a bunch of jokes from the 90s, you know, is the guy who actually has the strap. And nobody actually chases R-Truth down and actually tries to get the belt tonight. No one wanted the damn title, I guess, so they just let R-Truth go ahead and play. A lot more frustration from me than not tonight, and that's kind of like what I was saying on Raw, too. You know, again, as much as I enjoyed Heyman's promo and Orton's beatdown and certain things, there's still a lot of frustration. Like I said, I'm frustrated with the fact that Seth Rollins is made to feel like, you know, it kind of stupid. But I will say that beatdown from Orton on Raw did spin things in a little more of a positive direction for that story. I'm not happy that the Divas, I don't really care about that tag match, I'll be completely honest with you. But more so than that, just the fact that it's always predicated around Total Divas just is really, really overdone at this point. The Intercontinental title stuff, I'm not a fan of. The tag stuff tonight, I didn't enjoy. Eight-man tag was a mess as far as I was concerned. The Reigns stuff bothered me too, because again, it's like it takes all this crap to get Reigns to actually be aggressive. Why can't Reigns just be aggressive anyway? Why not? Well, if you want to prove that you can win the title, if you're, you know, want to make this guy look like he's ready to win that title, then why wouldn't he just go out there and you know, do that instead of looking like he was just going to walk away? It took Mark Henry to have to say that one thing to get him to light the fuse. And that's not what Roman Reigns should be about. If he wants to prove himself, then just go out there and prove himself rather than, you know, walking away from things and not confronting Heyman right off the bat when he talked down about his family. He was backstage. He had a match later in the show. It's not like they couldn't have had Roman Reigns come out on Raw and have a face-to-face with Brock. No reason. So, disappointment for me. This road to WrestleMania hasn't been good. I'm not afraid to admit it. I don't need to sit here and be like, oh, but they're doing good. Like, no, they're not. They're not. This hasn't been a good build. I'm not looking that forward to WrestleMania. And to think that there's only two more Raws and two more SmackDowns, if those even really count, until WrestleMania is kind of scary. Like, WrestleMania is only 2 weeks from this Sunday. And I'm not even feeling like WrestleMania is close by. And that's just a shame. Because I want to be really excited. I want to love everything they're doing. I want to be really into it and like, oh, I can't wait to watch WrestleMania 31 on the 29th. But I'm just like, oh, yeah, that's right. It's only 2 weeks away. Holy crap. So, I don't know. I'm just kind of disappointed with quite a few things. But you've heard me ramble on for enough time. If you have sat around and listened, I appreciate it more than I can say. I don't want to sound like a ranter. I don't want to just sound like this angry, angry fan who's mad about every damn thing, because that's not really how I am ever. But this buildup has been frustratingly bad. Let's be honest here. I don't really know too many people who are like ecstatically going nuts over the build to WrestleMania this year. Like, they can't wait for it. It just hasn't been good. It's been lacking. I thought last year's build was definitely a step up. There was a Raw in the build to WrestleMania last year that I handed an A- or an A out to, because it did such a good job of consistently building WrestleMania and selling me on the pay-per-view. Not too much of that has happened so far this year. I can't really say there's been a ton of segments that have sold me on the pay-per-view. Primarily, the main event and the big angles aren't selling me on the pay-per-view. Am I going to watch it? Of course. But, you know, again, I can still be critical of the product even though I watch it all the time, and I'm not going to stop watching it. I don't dislike it. I just don't love what I'm seeing. So I'm not really going to give SmackDown a grade, because I don't really think there's a letter grade to give it tonight. It's kind of just one of those shows where you just kind of go off and just talk about everything that's been going on with the build-up and the lack thereof, compelling build to get me into this. You know, storylines that look like they were going to happen that suddenly take this ridiculous change that didn't need to happen at all. A stupid multi-man match that isn't going to do anything for the belt. You know, a match that's as predictable as hell in Cena and Rusev. You know, things like that. You know, it's hard to look forward to things when you pretty much can already see the outcome, or, you know, it's just going to be a spot fest, or it's just a match to get a bunch of people on the card and it's not going to do anything for the winner. You know, though, it's like, I don't have an incentive to watch these matches if it's not going to end up doing anything for anybody. It's not going to even be a big moment. So I want WrestleMania 31 to be great. If the build isn't good and the show is good, then great. But the build hasn't been good, and it doesn't make me look like, it doesn't make me look on WrestleMania 31 with an amazingly bright disposition, as I may have with WrestleMania 30 last year. I had a really like good feeling about WrestleMania 30 last year, and it turned out really damn well, in my opinion. It was a really good WrestleMania, but I don't think this year is living up. This feels a little more like the year before, WrestleMania 29, when I was like, oh man. But that's not the most encouraging thing ever. Anyway, enough about SmackDown, enough about the build. This was less of a SmackDown review and more of just my thoughts on the, you know, WrestleMania build to this point, than anything else. So that's kind of why this ended up going a lot longer, than it may normally have. If I just did SmackDown, it probably would have been a 7 to 10 minute review, to be honest. Anyway, I hope you guys enjoyed it. Give me a like, comment your thoughts on the build as well as SmackDown. And of course, subscribe for plenty more to come. Like I said, Impact review tomorrow for those interested in TNA wrestling. And then, of course, Saturday, the Q&A. So, and then Monday will be the Raw review, and we'll go from there. Maybe a couple topical videos coming over the next couple weeks before WrestleMania to kind of help to build the show up for me. Maybe make me more excited about it. I don't know. Let's hope. I want to get into it. I do. I want to be excited about it. So it's more frustrating because you want to be like really into it because you love it. You love the product. You love the business. But it's hard to get into stuff when it's just frustrating the hell out of you and it's not even compelling you, you know. But hoping like hell WrestleMania 31 is a good show. Yeah. That's pretty much the basis here from here on out. You're gonna hear me say that in every single video that I upload from here until WrestleMania. I hope it's a good show. I really genuinely do. That's enough for me for tonight. Thanks for watching, guys. Till next time, peace out.